authentic that you were writing in a way nonfiction into fiction.
Yeah, and in some ways I was writing my own future into the book, which, because when I wrote, I was still happily married in my first marriage and never could have imagined being in a second marriage. And so yeah. It's just kind of bizarre how life, my life followed the book in some ways.
What is it? Life imitates art.
Yeah.
Right. In the translation that Zipporah is doing, and she sees that Daryl has had a child, she convinces him he must not impregnate her, but he must give her his sperm, and she will impregnate herself, which has, I mean, I've read enough real stories of this, and I will not forget somebody who came to a college reunion, and the question was, what was in the past year the most extraordinary thing you did? She had impregnated herself with a friend's sperm. Yeah. So
yeah, it's
those
an option,
things,
certainly.
Nothing is made up. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When Daryl goes to see Deborah's father, again, he is a man who has lost a daughter. He has left his wife, and he has remarried with a new child. Again, that's not so off, you know, from reality. What happens when people lose a child?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen that in people I know. I actually have several friends who have lost children, and in most cases their marriages did remain intact. But
is it going to be a sequel to this?
Oh gosh, if the characters decide they want to start talking again, I would love to spend more time with them. We'll see. I don't have anything in the works. I'm juggling a couple of other projects right now.
Well, Ava is somebody who's not going to leave you alone.
Oh, that's for sure.
She's an animator. That's how she makes her living. And she has the ability to make body sounds with her computer, all right, for animation. She is desperate to find who is my real father, or just who is my father. Mm-hmm. And she decides it has to be the reverend of a big church in Los Angeles. And she goes there, and she doesn't realize that to be baptized, it had to be her baptism, not her baby's.
I'm thankful that that wasn't the case when we went to baptize Asher in Denmark. That ended up being a big surprise for Ava.
Yeah.
Because she wanted to do this to connect with this man that she thinks is her father, and ends up underwater.
How did you decide he would be the man and she would do something like this?
It's hard to say. It just kind of emerged as I wrote. It wasn't a plan.
Yeah.
I don't know if part of me was influenced by the LA riots and just thinking that it would be interesting to bring my Korean characters into a more African-American community. Although, of course, her father would be African-American no matter where he lived.
But now he's an outstanding minister in a big, big church on the South Side. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
But I love the way she has said to him, I am your daughter, and there's a big, the whole congregation is in shock. But his mother comes to pay a call that afternoon, and she says, it couldn't be my son, he was never in Vietnam.
Yeah, Korea, it would have been. Yeah, she says he wasn't, and who knows if she's telling the truth. She might be trying to protect her son. I don't want to give too much away, but Daryl does do some DNA testing toward the end of the book. Poor Ava just wants to know where she comes from. She wants to know who gave her baby the gene that made the baby ill.
Yeah.
And she's so convinced it's this
man. Evidently, any parent who has a child with sickle cell anemia lives half awake, because they can never sleep if that child is there in the house because of something called a crisis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and my goodness, just what a horrible thing for parents to have to go through. I have a 2-year-old son myself who just went through some high fevers, and just seeing him go through that was horrible. I also have a 21-year-old and an 18-year-old, so it's quite amazing to be going through this process all over again.
How old were you when the 21-year-old was born?
I was 22.
Oh, you look like you could be 22 still.
Thank you.
Yeah. What is that 21-year-old doing?
He's about to graduate from college. He's getting a degree in linguistics.
Where?
At UCR, so right in Riverside.
Yeah. Now, at the same time, this was perking inside you. There was another book that we did that was fascinating on people who go to self-storages where, if they haven't paid, that storage room is up for grabs.
Yeah, that novel's called Self-Storage, and it explores the world of self-storage auctions, which have become very popular with the Storage Wars reality show, and I think there's one other one which I haven't seen yet. But at the time, I don't think it was a very well-known
thing. No, it was a very new idea. Yeah,
and I actually found out about it on an airplane that I wasn't even supposed to be on. I had switched my flight, and the woman next to me told me that she went to these self-storage auctions, and I was so intrigued because she explained that you got a minute at that time to just stand outside the locker. You couldn't go inside of it. You could shine a flashlight into it, but often you never would know what was inside these boxes and bags and would bid on it, just hoping there would be treasure inside.
And the woman who was your protagonist was in the middle of a very unhappy marriage.
Yeah, her husband was ostensibly working on his PhD, but he was obsessed with soap operas and spent most of his time watching TV.
Yeah. You know what, I can't help but hear. Your life has been a matter of non-planning, and what what comes into it out of left field.
Yeah, I feel like as a writer, my main task is to stay open because I never know where inspiration is going to come from. And so I feel like it's my job to keep my mind open, my heart open, my senses open, and you know, inspiration will come from somewhere. I often tell people that for me, writing is like breathing, and not just because it feels organic to me, but because as a writer, I take the world into myself. It's like inhaling, and then when I write, it's like exhaling, giving myself back out. And so you never know what's going to come through that whole respiration process.
Do you do much rewriting?
I do, and when I was a young writer, I used to hate revision. I used to be scared of it. I thought that it took the initial creative juice away from my work. Cutting a sentence felt like cutting off a finger. It was painful. And now I relish it because it gives me a chance to really polish the work, you know, fill up the holes. Just it helps me take that raw material and create it into something more beautiful.
I'm going to just ask you to read the first two paragraphs so they can get a feel of your writing. But this is Zipporah's translation of the grandmother.
This is Zipporah's translation, and I should mention that there's a parenthetical remark where Zipporah is directly addressing Daryl. She's starting to insert herself into the text. The girl cried in her bed all night. She missed his body, the warm bulk of it. She missed the smoothness of his hands on her stomach, the curve of his hip bone fitting into hers. Do I miss you, Daryl? No, I don't. Not at all. Z. Then she goes back to the translation. She was groggy, sandy-eyed when she walked up to the chateau with the crock of butter. She hadn't slept. She forgot to put the pillow that she had clutched all night under her dress. None of her colleagues remembered it either. Fortunately, her belly was quite round. If any of the German soldiers asked, she could say she had been wearing an extra petticoat the day before. And at this point, Daryl's grandmother is acting as a spy, and she is pregnant, but she's putting a pillow under her dress to make it seem as if she's further along, so they would be less likely to suspect her.
And it's there that she meets the Lithuanian, who will later become the father, the grandfather in America.
Yes, who she feels that she doesn't really have a choice at that point. The man who she loved has been taken away, and she's carrying his child, but this other man gives her an opportunity for a new life.
What's interesting is that the book is in many ways just not that thick, but there is so much story in it, and so many interesting people that you have made, especially his parents. I cannot put away Daryl's parents, who then come to the, I was going to say bar mitzvah, but the baptism, and they're there.
Yeah.
Well, I wish you all the best, and I hope happy family.
Thank you.
Happy graduation, Gail.
Will you autograph
my book?
Of course, my pleasure.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier, and you can link in to YouTube, where the show with Gail will be on in about 2 weeks. But support your local library. Go in, take out a card, and that is how they get funding. Another book that also is about that period in Russia is Susan Sherman's book, The Little Russian. Equally improbable, but probable, because it really happened. And the library is our finest font of information and democracy. Anyone can go in, get a card, and truly learn how to read. And I hope they are teaching them phonics, because that to me was the greatest asset that I learned from reading. What did the library mean to you growing up, Gail?
Oh, it meant everything. Books have always been so important to me, and it was such a treat to go to the library. I grew up in Evanston, Illinois, and there was one small branch that I could walk to, but then there was the big downtown branch that my mom would drive me to, and I would just get lost there.
And we can only say, enjoy your library, thank the librarian, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Gail.
Thank you so much, Connie. It was really a pleasure to be back here.
Thank you.